Department of Health Secretary Francisco Duque III. Welcome back to Hot Copy, Secretary Duque.
Yes, thank you very much. And in behalf of the DOH, I'd like to thank you for the gracious invite and glad to be back, Karen, to your very good show.
All right, let's start first with the COVID cases. We are seeing a spike, Secretary, with frankly Quezon City and Davao. Have you studied and can you attribute the reasons why these two particular cities have rising numbers?
Well, what we have seen, for example, in Quezon City, I think the bulk of the increase came from the reported clustering of cases in Batasan, in Congress, and that has been addressed. I have spoken with Mayor Joy Belmonte, and she has already gotten the list of where these people in Batasan live, and so that they could aggressively pursue testing and contact tracing, isolation and quarantine. So hopefully we'll see a downtrend anytime soon. And Davao City is also correctly, as you have pointed out, they have increased cases. I think this has something to do with their having de-escalated their community quarantine to MGCQ. Mm-mm. And so because of that, there has been an increase in mobility of people, thereby increasing contact rate and transmission. And so this is largely the reasons why you've seen an uptick in these areas. Well, not only Quezon City and Davao City, as you correctly pointed out, Laguna, Rizal, Benguet, mm-hmm. etc. But that happens, but we're ready. The 9-month experience of controlling this pandemic has taught us a lot of really good lessons that we can readily mm-hmm. implement in hotspot areas.
Okay, how would you describe the virus today in terms of, let's start with Quezon City, Davao, and Benguet, no? Is it, for example, has the virus weakened? Are most of the patients asymptomatic? Are they mild?
Well, for the last 9 months of our experience, we have seen that about 85% are mild symptomatics, and about 10% close to about 10% would be asymptomatic, and the rest would be moderate, severe, and critical.
But mostly now, is it weaker? Is it mild now? Secretary, would you describe that now? Most of the cases, are they mild in nature?
Oh, yes. By and large, the majority of cases, as I've told you, mild symptomatic would be about 85 to 90%. And then you have your asymptomatic would be about 5%, 3 to 5%. And then the rest, as I've said, would constitute your moderate, your severe, about 2%. And your critical would be about 2 to 3%. And you know, I'd like to point out, Karen, that the recovery rate as of yesterday is about 93%. So this is really a good number, and we hope to be able to achieve a higher than 95% recovery rate.
Okay, what is your estimate this Christmas season? We've seen it in the U.S. after Thanksgiving. The numbers have spiked, but given the stricter rules that the IATF has actually given for the Christmas season, are you predicting an increase in the numbers?
Oh, yes, definitely. We are. And that's why we're ready. It's better to assume that it's going to go up rather than be complacent and imagine that it's not going to go up, despite the obvious circumstances that Christmas, you know, people are really more likely to congregate, go to the malls, to the markets. In fact, I've done my rounds and I continue to mm-hmm. do my rounds. Okay. I've seen the traffic, the foot traffic has definitely
increased.
But there are, public markets that I've initially visited that really showed good management and administration, like one in Cubao, Farmers Market, where I saw for myself and my team that the measures, the preventive measures, health promotion measures are really very effectively implemented. But there is also in the divisoria when I went there, and I was really aghast by the density of people doing their shopping, etc. So I and the mayor had to repeatedly.
So what's your advice? Halimbawa, maganda po yan, something practical, divisoria. Is there a strategy or a plan that you and Mayor Isko spoke about to minimize the number of people in a certain spot at one point in time?
Kasama po natin dito, we have the law enforcement agencies, no? The Okay, so there are the marshals there, and they go to these high density areas, marketplaces, and then they remind people, sabi ko nga, magdala sila ng 1 meter stick to visualize, for people to visualize what 1 meter distance looks like. Because some people, it's not surprising, akala nila yung 1 foot parang isang metro, so pwede na yung ganon. So it's different when you really demonstrate it. And so hopefully people's consciousness or awareness will be implemented. And so we also have online, we're pushing for online shopping because that's the safest mode of shopping nowadays, no? We have to decrease contact, no, and transmission, and online shopping, online parties, and Zoom meetings, you know, webinars. These are all platforms on which we can do important things.
Okay. All right. Moving forward, let's talk about the vaccine, vaccine, vaccine. It's all about that. Senator Bongo challenges you and Secretary Galvez to take the vaccine first to assuage the fears of the public. Are you willing to be one of those to be first inoculated?
Oh, yes, definitely. That's no brainer, Karen. I'll take it for as long as it has undergone the scientific evaluation by the DOST's vaccine experts panel and the ethics board review and the FDA's own technical and regulatory evaluation. I'll take
it. No, but are you saying after FDA approval? Because when the president issued an executive order allowing the FDA to grant emergency use authorization, you'd take it already after that?
Yes, sure, Karen. No problem. Okay. I can also, even, get and encourage all my fellow cabinet members, all the other officials of government, to join me.
All right. Now, explain the emergency use authorization in a practical sense. What would this mean to the Filipino public, essentially, when it comes to time?
I'm glad you mentioned time. It's going to be really streamlined, the approval process. I think when I spoke to DG Eric Domingo of FDA, he said it will take about 3 weeks to process and grant the emergency use authorization to whoever applies. Okay. But those who apply must still go through the process of, as I have said earlier, the evaluation, the scientific evaluation by the vaccine expert panel, the review, the ethics review board. And then the FDA is currently preparing the guidelines for the implementation of the EO121 grant of EUA. And this will cut down the processing time tremendously without necessarily compromising on the safety and efficacy of the vaccine candidates.
Okay. All right. So something practical. Britain is essentially the first country with a queen volunteering to be one of the first to be inoculated already. I think they're using, is it Pfizer in Britain, Secretary? Pfizer ba sila? It is, no?
No, I think that's the question in my mind. Supposed to be an American company, and has its own AstraZeneca. So I'm confused whether the Queen actually wants to be inoculated with a vaccine from an American company, although it was America.
Yes, that was in the news. So my question is, given that Britain is publicly declaring that they will already start very soon. And I think it might be even this month, the latest in January. When it comes to the Philippines, we're a developing nation. We aren't producing any of these vaccines. Where are we, Secretary, in terms of, number one, availability, purchase? Government po muna ha, kasi the private sector is already purchasing on their own. But for the government, what is the priority? What brand is the priority at this point, and is it available?
Well, we're looking at a portfolio of different vaccines, no? Because the supply will not be
enough.
No? So, iba-iba yan, no? So, depending on the availability, depending on the outcome of the evaluation for the end of the day, Karen, it's all about the safety, efficacy, and the practicability of implementation. Kasi may ibang bakuna. Kailangan -70, -70, -80 degrees centigrade.
So, for the Philippines...
Diyos ko, paano naman yun? Di ba kung wala tayo noon? What investments will be required to set that cold storage, very sophisticated cold storage requirement? So, you know, we have to look at the practicability of implementation.
Yeah. So for the Philippines, given everything that you have just told me, which vaccine do you believe is practical for the Philippines?
Well, so far there has been a list of vaccine candidates. You have Sinovac, you have Gamaleya, you have AstraZeneca, I think Sinopharm is also there, and Johnson, Gamaleya, I said, no?
Sputnik, yes, yes.
Sputnik V, and also Johnson by Johnson & Johnson. So I think they require a much less sophisticated and a bit higher, a higher cold storage temperature of anywhere from negative 20 to about positive 2 to about positive 8 degrees centigrade.
Okay, so is it fair that when it comes to Pfizer, because for Pfizer you need between 2 to 8 degrees Celsius for at least 6 months, making it compatible with DOH storage facilities, would it be fair to say Pfizer would... that's not something the Philippines can use right away, given the requirement, Secretary?
No, well, the requirement of Pfizer is negative 70 to negative 80 degrees centigrade. That's Pfizer and Moderna, in fact. But all the rest, not using the mRNA platform, they will require a less sophisticated...
Tama kayo, sir, sa Pfizer, oo.
Oh, sa Pfizer, mataas, negative 70.
Negative 70 Celsius. Okay. So is this more difficult for the Philippines?
Oh yeah, it's going to be more difficult for
So we don't have the storage facilities for this.
No, we don't have that as of the moment, according to the DTI information that I got.
So it's fair to say that Pfizer won't be in a way top priority only because we don't have the infrastructure to keep the Pfizer vaccines. Tama, sir?
Well, tama yon. But I'm also hearing from Secretary Galvez, our vaccine czar, very hardworking vaccine czar, that Pfizer might be willing to actually provide the very sophisticated negative 70 degrees centigrade cold storage to ensure the effectiveness and safety of the vaccines. You know, it's very difficult, this new, relatively new vaccine platform. No? This is using the mRNA. It's a bit technical, but I just want to underscore the fact that bago po itong teknolohiya ng Pfizer. Wala po tayong karanasan, hindi katulad ng mga iba na meron tayo for mumps, Zika, polio, measles, na ginamit po nila yung lumang teknolohiya. Kaya parang ako, mas kampante po ako na gamitin itong nagkaroon na po tayo ng karanasan. Yung mga bago kasi, although there were already clinical trials done for mRNA for I think SARS-CoV-1 and MERS-CoV, no? So hindi naman parang they're starting from scratch, no? But they've done some clinical trials for the two viruses I mentioned, and they're capitalizing on that. No?
Okay, so you're right, actually, no. So technically speaking, AstraZeneca, that's the one that's just 2 to 8 degrees Celsius. That's the one compatible with the DOH storage facilities. Pwede po ito, is this a priority, AstraZeneca, in terms of purchase?
Well, as I've said, it's one of the considerations in a bag of vaccines or a pool of vaccines that we would like to set up. No? So mix a portfolio tayo.
Okay. Sinovac, for example, there are already businessmen that have been inoculating themselves, frankly, with Sinovac. This is the one from China, I believe, tama ba, Secretary?
Yes, that is the Sinovac from China, but the information whether some individuals or personalities have actually inoculated themselves secretly,
yes,
that I have no information.
Okay, now, the reason I'm asking this is some sources tell me that they are offering Sinovac, that's of course 2 doses, and some are charging for it. Is this legal to do? Or it's not exactly against the law? Where does the government stand on this?
Oh, well, we're quite definitive on our stand. You cannot be using any product in the Philippines that has not been evaluated nor assessed for its safety and efficacy. So it's a risk that people are taking. So I don't know. I have no idea. But it's wrong to do that because you're skirting the rule of law and regulatory mandates of agencies.
Ba-o. And to charge, let's say, for Sinovac, for a person to be inoculated, to charge certain amounts for it, will there be penalties for that?
Well, as I've said, there is even no FDA EUA granted to this product. No, you and I know that, Karen.
Okay? Yeah.
So, hindi talaga pwede. So, whatever amount they charge, to me, it begins from the fact that walang authorization. So, anything that happens after that is not legit.
Ba-o. Okay, Gamaleya Research Institute.
Of course, FDA will penalize if upon investigation, it will be able to establish probable cause for people who have violated or skirted regulatory mandates.
Ba-o. Now, Gamaleya Research Institute, I actually interviewed the CEO of RFID or the Russian Investment Fund. And itong Sputnik V, I think, is it right? It has a 95% efficacy, they say. Where are we? Because we were supposed to be included, am I right, Secretary, in the clinical trials of 1,000 people in the Philippines?
Yes, that's right. I think Gamaleya is in the list of those who have applied for the conduct of clinical trial phase 3 in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. And to me, that should be encouraged, and I think that is good for us. But it's not an absolute requirement. For as long as the clinical trials have been conducted in the originating countries of the vaccines, then all those documents will have to be submitted for further evaluation by the technical and regulatory body.
Okay. Now they say, of course, the devil is in the details when it comes to actually inoculating millions of people. So some practical questions now for you, Secretary. How will this be distributed, and do you have to build inoculation centers, or will be using barangay centers na lang po ba?
Well, that depends on the requirement of each of the vaccines, sir, because they're not all the same. As I've said, they will require different temperatures, no? And what is our current capacity? How much do we need to enhance those capacities? But by and large, we have been doing inoculation or vaccination for the last 4 decades, no? So measles, DPT, polio, BCG, etc. So we'll use, we'll piggyback the existing system. It's in place. But we need to enhance the capacity because there has never been a history. There has never been in the history of DOH
of a mass vaccination.
Yeah. Huge number of people at 60 to 70 million. No? So it will take time to really do an end-to-end process and make sure that from production to shipping to storage, distribution, disposal, you know, it's a long
Do you need
and process.
Now, Secretary, do you need to train additional personnel for this or not necessarily so?
Absolutely. We need more people. And so, you know, they're going to inoculate, but it's not going to be, you know, it's not going to be sophisticated or complicated. It's, you know, the training is going to be simplified.
Uh-oh. When it comes to syringes, I wanted to read this to you. The budget right now of the government is 73 billion pesos for the procurement of vaccines, right, for herd immunity. But there's also another budget that's being set aside in other countries for syringes, for example. UNICEF is buying 5 billion safety boxes used for syringes. You also have other companies that are setting aside budgets for syringes. Have we played that in already, or that's already included in the 73 billion, Secretary?
Well, let me give you the breakdown. No?
Apo.
We have 73.2 billion all in all. 40 billion will is proposed to be sourced from multilateral project loans, ADB and World Bank. The 20 billion will is proposed to come from domestic sources such as Land Bank, DBP and other GFIs or GOCCs. And the 13.2 billion is supposed to support the requirement for the actual vaccination, which means procurement of syringes, the some storage, refrigeration equipment, the disposal, et cetera. So the 13.2 billion is going to cover the peripherals, so to speak, to complete the implementation of our national COVID-19 immunization plan.
Oo. Now, is 73 billion enough to achieve herd immunity, Secretary? Because Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo said that at least 140 billion is needed.
We'll have to validate, you know, differing computations. No? Mm. We'll have to look at the details or the basis for the different computation that the good Congresswoman has put forward.
Uh-oh.
So we'll cross-check, we'll juxtapose all these computations, and we'll go down, even go down to the detailed costing, no, of the peripherals.
Uh-oh. Would it help if the national ID, or would you want the national ID system in place already or put into use when we inoculate millions of Filipinos? Or is it even possible, but to I don't know, frankly, with the timeline that we have, is it possible to already make that effective?
Hindi pa siguro, Karen, because I think we're only about 8, 9 million now of those of the population that is registered, no, for the national ID. But ideally, that would be wonderful. That's going to make our work much easier. Because, you know, now you have to, cannot just be projection, no? Yung figures lang, sinasabi natin, ito yung priority listing, ito yung mga mababakuna. We need now, we need addresses. We need this list down to the barangay level. And so we're going to talk with the local government units through the DILG and plan on really setting up the registry for our forthcoming vaccination.
Okay, there's a good question here coming from the private sector. With the president's emergency use authorization, will this cover private companies? Please ask the secretary. In other words, I think they mean if a private company wants to import on their own, like you're a big conglomerate, and then you inoculate your own employees. This is to get the economy going again. Are private companies included in this emergency use authorization?
Yeah, the EUA, I understand, is applicable to all. So whether you're a private sector or national government as the state procurer or the national program implementer, So you can apply for the EUA. So for as long as it goes through the process that I have enumerated with regard to ensuring safety and efficacy and practicability of implementation.
Okay. Moving on, I know you have a meeting, Secretary, but I hope you can indulge me. Just very quickly, about testing, I wanted to ask you already about the antigen testing. Will this be more widely used, especially for opening the economy up? There's been a debate, and of course, let's say opening tourism, you have some areas wanting PCR testing, and we know it's expensive, even if you put a cap, no, of four or five per person for a middle class family or lower middle class family won't get them to travel. Where are we now when it comes to PCR pero antigen use?
Yeah, meron na tayong guidelines niyan, Karen, no? And for as long as the implementation or the use of the rapid antigen testing is in accordance with those guidelines, that can be done. You know? But the guidelines underscores the fact that this is used only for those who are symptomatic, people who have the history of exposure to a COVID case, confirmed COVID case, or a history of travel with high caseload of COVID-19,
really?
In areas where there is really difficult access to RT-PCR, and if there is an indication of an impending outbreak in the certain communities. So these are fundamentally what the guidelines state. So hindi pa rin natin pwedeng gamitin ito for non-symptomatics or outside of those conditions that I have enumerated.
Okay. So kung ganun po, since of course RT-PCR is the gold standard, the last one I've read is they have a delay in submitting results. So I think there are 15 labs that still didn't submit results to the DOH as of yesterday. But then, frankly speaking, 4-5 is still a bit steep. And many have made this into a private enterprise that, frankly, it's become profitable for them. Do you plan, Secretary, to decrease even the price? Because if Red Cross is doing it, I think, at 3-5, can't these private labs go down even more?
Oh yes, we are doing a monthly monitoring to implement the joint administrative order of the DOH and the DTI to see whether there's going to be a downward movement of the input cost. No? Kasi yan is largely influenced by the cost of the test kits,
okay,
the overhead cost, the human resource cost, the operational cost, etc. And the study that was done by our expert consultants considered all of these parameters, no?
Okay.
In establishing the price range for private sector at 4-5 to 5, and for government sector it's 3,800. And since everyone naman is a member of PhilHealth, so the out-of-pocket also is not that much, because even at 4-5, less 3-8, so that's about 700 na lang out-of-pocket.
Okay.
That makes it really affordable.
Yeah. Speaking of PhilHealth, before we go, what can you do to frankly make PhilHealth pay the Red Cross already at least the 500 million plus they still owe? Because the last time I spoke with Senator Gordon, the dues have already increased to something like 650 million. He says it's a moving target. PhilHealth is not paying based on the contract agreement of every 3 days. What can you do, Secretary, to make them pay?
Well, I have spoken to the President and CEO, Attorney Garan, and have in fact reminded him of the outstanding liability or balance payable to PRC, and they're trying their best to really validate all these claims, no? And they're just being cautious and prudent to make sure that they don't get held to investigating bodies and charged for paying without clear basis. So they are just being cautious, and no problem with that, because this is taxpayers' money, and so the prudence is entirely justifiable.
Okay, before we go, I wanted to ask you, your leadership has been criticized by senators openly in the past, but you've had the president defending you outright, and the president even called you an innocent man. This is a direct quote, it's not my quote. And this was over the interim reimbursement mechanism, or the IRM issue. I know at one point that, was it right to say that you already wanted to resign at one point? And how are you dealing with criticisms against you moving forward?
Well, you know, this is all part of the job. No? Being a public servant, you cannot, as the saying goes, if you cannot stand the heat, you better get out. But of course, there are times when the allegations are baseless, malicious, and really derogatory, that can hurt your family. You know, I will be the first one to admit that it did hurt me. But you know, Karen, I think the president really knows what his people do in the discharge of their duties and responsibilities. The president has a very deep, intelligence. So he knows which of his cabinet members are engaged in nefarious activities, highly irregular, malfeasance. So president knows my track record. I've served under four presidents, you know, twice Secretary of Health, Chairman of GSIS, and Civil Service Commission, and have spent a great deal of my life serving with integrity and probity, with competence, the Filipino people. And he understands where I'm coming from.
But what, moving forward, are there changes in terms of your own responsibilities? Because you, frankly speaking, you're a member of 69 task forces, commissions, and committees. Is it still at 69? Or what did you do to make it more effective, frankly, your presence more effective? Are you still in 69 task forces?
Yes, close.
Until now?
Close to that, except for, I think it's all by legislation. The membership of the secretary in commissions, in boards, in task forces, is really by way of legislation. So I would like to suggest to our legislators to really carefully look at this kind of ex officio designations, as this could affect the effectiveness of the Secretary of Health. No? But I have trusted deputies. No? For example, in PhilHealth, when I was out for about 4 months, when they were implementing the interim reimbursement mechanism, by law, my vice chair, who assumes the chairmanship every time I am indisposed, is the president and CEO. So meron naman akong mga deputies.
Okay, moving forward with PhilHealth, what is the biggest change you believe that PhilHealth should do?
Well, it's the fraud detection, fraud deterrence, everything around the fraud prevention, you know. So that is one of the three marching orders of the president, to repair the tattered image of PhilHealth. But you know, unfair din naman sa PhilHealth, kasi as a matter of fact, the IRM objective was good. The intention was good. It's just that somewhere in the implementation, nagkaroon ng problema. But by and large, the fraud control, the repairing the image, the tattered image of PhilHealth and the continuous education of the public as to their benefit rights. When they need it, they should be able to clearly understand what is the support that PhilHealth gives in terms of decreasing out-of-pocket expenditure. And for the poor, we have the low balance billing policy that is increasing hopefully to about 100% in as soon as possible, of course.
All right, last question. Just give me an idea on the target date when we will start inoculating Filipinos. What's doable and when is the soonest?
Well, you know, we've done some scenario analysis under the leadership of Secretary Galvez. And I think the best case scenario would be about end of first quarter 2021.
Okay.
Or about start of second quarter of next year. So a lot of factors will have to be taken into consideration to really be able to more definitively set the schedules for actual distribution, deployment, and inoculation of our people within our priority list.
Okay, so roughly, will be, kumbaga, it'll be suerte tayo kung end of the first quarter, that'll be around March, right? That's what you're saying?
Yes.
Tama, ng 2021. Correct. All right. Well, on that note, Secretary Duque, I want to thank you for joining us in Head Start. We do hope that you join us again for updates. It's very important that people hear from you. So thank you so much. You stay strong, sir, and you stay safe.
Thank you very much, Karen. And keep well yourself and until the next time. Thank you.
All right.